What a hero. I had people in my chat saying that his death was unfair because they brutally murdered, and I quote, a beloved character.
Yeah!
He is.
He's beloved
he
as
is.
Fuck!
There's, wait, you Red. Can like you can prove this metrically. Like, it's pretty fucking easy. Joel skyrocketed as iconic characters from video games on Sony's like catalog.
Yeah, like the backlash to this game basically proves how beloved he was to everybody.
Yeah, the fact that people are so mad should indicate that people liked him a lot. Mm-hmm.
How about we look at just the Wikipedia article for Joel? Give me one sec, Joel. Last of Us, and then we'll look at reception. Okay, we'll just
no, just go to top five Sony characters.
Mm-hmm.
Go to top five PS4 characters or something like that. Top five PS4 characters.
Okay, we've got Joel's character received generally positive feedback. Colin Moriarty found that he cared about the character and considered him likable. Andy Kelly of Computer and Video Games wrote that Joel has a likable warmth in his laconic Texan drawl. Jim Sterling of Destructoid found Joel likable despite his impatience and harsh tone. Eurogamer's Ollie Welsh felt that by the game's end, Joel and Ellie had matured from cliches into rounded characters.
I got this list. It's got Joel and Ellie.
I found one. Best PlayStation 3 characters. Number one, Nathan Drake. Number two, Joel.
Yeah.
I like how number three is Kratos, number four is John Marston, number five is Ellie. Joel is beloved. Fuck you.
I love Joel.
It's so ridiculous. It's like, how could anyone possibly think it? It's like, this is actually a quote from my chat. It's like, yeah, he literally is a beloved character.
People why would you really like The Last of Us 1 if they didn't like Joel?
He's kind of integral to it.
He's a playable character. What the? Okay.
Wouldn't really suck to play a game with a character, with a protagonist who's unlikable? Gosh.
But you see how it's then so easy to frame this and to set up like this straw man argument? It's like, well, he was never really that beloved anyway. And it's like, you shouldn't feel bad about him dying because he wasn't that popular and he wasn't a good person.
Sour grapes, man.
Actually, you're right. So the argument here, if we ignore what he just said, the argument is a beloved character shouldn't get a death like this, I suppose. I would just argue it shouldn't be treated this way. But then no character should be treated this way, as nonsensically as this. Like,
yeah.
I'm okay with him dying brutally. I am not okay with the circumstances leading up to him dying brutally being bullshit. And I'm very not okay with being told that we should sympathize with a person who sadistically tortures him to death in front of his surrogate daughter and think, oh, she's such a good person, when her motivation is bullshit.
If I was in charge of making this game, I would have been like, oh, we got to make a sequel. Oh, well, Joe's going to die a hero's death. That's what's going to happen. This is what we're doing. It makes sense. It'll be super satisfying to everybody. People will love it. He'll go down in history as a great character. He's going to have so much respect. It's just all wins. We're just passing out W's at this point. It's just the obvious thing to do that makes so much sense on every level. And they're like, no, let's do the opposite. Fuck it.
I mean, the fact that, like, so a character being beloved doesn't necessarily mean that they're well written. It's just, you know, they're positively received in general, right? This is a consensus
based argument.
Yeah. You know, this is a like beloved depends on, basically you have to understand, okay, the 90% of people receive the character positively. Yes. Okay.
Well, like they're legitimately positive. Fat Geralt is that he doesn't have to be written well. But he's beloved anyway.
Just like the Dawn.
Crazy.
I mean, how could you not love a character whose on-screen debut is him barreling into the frame with a fully wound-up punch against someone a quarter of his size straight into a garage door, causing them to twirl comically?
Dude, it's not even... I'm going to make a case in my video for Fat Geralt to a certain degree, but... You know, like, he immediately is like, hey, how you doing, buddy? Like, you got an arrow through you. And the guy's like, oh, fuck it. He's like, you'll be okay. Come on. And then he snaps it, pulls it out, and he's like, right, get that sword, and then get the girl out of here. Just like, hey, this guy, This guy is doing stuff. Like, he knows what's up. He knows what's to do. You just get a sense immediately, like, huh, he seems competent.
You can have
yeah, he doesn't mess power. Around. He knows how to take someone down. He demonstrates a certain degree of concern for his comrades. You know, okay, you've established him pretty there. He's an effective leader.
Someone's going to be like, it's a slaver. And he'll be like, well.
Well, I mean, here's a good example. I last night I was watching some clips of, do you guys remember Hank Scorpio from The Simpsons?
Yeah.
One of the greatest one-off characters. And everybody in the comments is like, I'd like to work for him. It's like, he's a supervillain. It's like, yeah, but he's nice to his employees, you know? He's cool. He wants to go bowling with Homer. Like, that's what I mean. It only takes like a few minutes to establish somebody is really cool. Attention, good evening, gentlemen. I have the doomsday device. Like,
it's like when Homer asks for sugar from him and he's just got it in his pockets. Like, loose sugar.
Like, Mr. Bond, stop him! He's supposed to die!
Do you remember when
Homer just rugby tackles him to the ground?
When Homer, I think Homer, he says like good because I don't have any cream, like in relation to sugar in his pockets, like as if
he's got sugar like loose for Homer, and then he's like, you want some cream? And Homer looks at him for a second, like no.
I really like the part at the end where he's like, Homer, if you could kill someone on your way out, it would really help me a lot. Jump down with a flamethrower. So good.
And yet,
welcome to the episode of EFAP where we cover Cosmonaut Variety Hour. We'll be discussing the episode of The Simpsons with a one-off character written better than the protagonist of the game.
Joel is not a fucking beloved character.
He is, though.
That's insane to say that. Like, this is where you wanna ask a few people before you say stuff like this.
Yeah, listen, I'm okay with the idea of you're like, I don't particularly like this character, but yes, they're beloved. Like, if he wants to take that position, that's totally fine. But to state outwardly, it's like, people don't love this character. What do you mean? It's like, what are you talking about?
You're losing us, Cosmonaut. You see, you made some valid points with the gameplay mechanic stuff, but now you're just going off the rails.
I mean, let's put it this way. I've played half of the first game, watched the rest. I have not played the second game and watched all of it. I love Joel so much. All right.
This
like,
game has made me realize that I like Joel a lot.
Joel's fucking awesome.
I think there's a lot of people in your position.
Yeah, who were just like, oh, he was really cool.
Yeah, like, man, Joel was great.
Realize that. Yeah.
This is where, like, Cosmonaut is outright, like, denying objective facts. If you say a character is not beloved because you don't like them personally, it's like you're ignoring the fact that, well, the majority of people do, and the definition of beloved is, you know, definition of beloved.
Yeah,
beloved.
He is about as beloved as he can, yeah.
It's a matter of like popularity.
It's not even down to necessarily whether Cosmonaut likes Joel, it's just he's setting it up like this to support his argument that he's constructed for this game.
Yeah, it's like, people don't like Jesus.
It's about what people like. It's not what he likes or even their character necessarily. It's just if people as a whole like the character. That's what makes a beloved character.
Pretty much.
Yeah, like, I'm not going to... Like,
a much loved... That's literally the... That's Joel. He is a much loved person.
Is that loved to a significant degree or loved by a lot of people?
A much loved...
Much loved person.
I feel like much loved seems person. Like it could be interchangeable between the two of them, seemingly.
Yeah. Because he's both, by the way.
Yeah.
You'd have to make a strong case to suggest that most people don't love Joel.
Oh, he is many loved by much people, definitely.
The thing that I think a lot of people found so appealing is that he's like a fucking rock, and he's chipped away by this innocent girl who just looking to have fun in a horrible world, and then you eventually lose. You'll sacrifice anything to help her.
Yeah,
that's some adorable shit right there. Like, really gets to people's hearts quickly.
And yeah. they make Ellie like an actually endearing person too, so that you're feeling that alongside him. Like, she's kind of annoying at first, and then she's breaking him down, but at the same time, she's breaking you down too.
Yeah, she's incredibly hard to hard to dislike. No, sorry, whatever. The point is that it takes a while for her to get to Joel. It's not quick.
Especially when she's like giving you ammunition and she's saving your life during combat encounters. You're dealing with a guy that's you know, attacking you, and he's grabbing onto you from behind. She jumps on his back and starts, you know, shanking the shit out of him. She throws bricks and bottles at people when you're out of ammo and almost about to die, so you can get the advantage on them. It's like, ugh.
Also, as Silver Groove just highlighted, people are mad that Joel died. That's it. Also, Joel isn't even beloved. Wait a minute.
Yeah, which one is it? I'm so upset that this character I hate died. This character I didn't
Winnie
care
the Pooh
about.
Is a beloved character. Joel is a
fuck Winnie the Pooh. I hate Winnie the Pooh so goddamn much.
I don't give a shit
That's
about
a
Winnie the Pooh.
Oddly specific.
Winnie the Pooh.
Who feels deep love for Winnie the Pooh?
I'm sorry, especially considering what Winnie the Pooh is doing in China right now. Like you look at how China is reacting to Winnie the Pooh and what all of his horrible actions as the dictator in that country. I don't.
Well, who's your everyone? I guess while we're on the set, who's everyone's favorite character from the Hundred Acre Wood? I mean, does anyone have a favorite?
I like Tigger more than Winnie the Pooh.
I love Tigger and Rabbit way more than Winnie the Pooh.
I like Piglet more than Winnie. Yeah, Winnie the Pooh is like the
Winnie's pretty generic.
Is like the Mario series, you know, like everyone's favorite is not Mario. It's Luigi. It's Yoshi. It's Bowser. It's Waluigi. It's someone else. It's not Mario.
Do the movies count? Like the videos count? Because Gopher is pretty fucking great.
Yeah, I remember Gopher.
Gopher's
good.
That's awesome.
He may not be in the book, but oof.
I'm probably gonna go with I like Rabbit. He's sort of straight man, you know, trying to keep it all together, trying to keep things. You know, I bet he puts up with a lot of stuff. I bet there's a lot of love in that rabbit to put up with all these people, you know. He's just trying to get by, sticks around. Then probably Kanga.
Rabbit is like the Squidward of Winnie the Pooh in that he becomes a lot more relatable the older you grow, you know?
Oh, yeah. He's like, man, this dude is trying to keep it together. He's trying to grow carrots. And he just wants a nice house. And he has very attainable, simple goals.
By the
and,
way.
Yeah.
Like, because he's putting Joel against Winnie the fucking Pooh. Like, I don't even know what to do. So, the idea, like, because it's funny because I'm willing to take it on. I'd be like, yeah, so why do you think people have a deeper love for Joel? It's like, because he's far more endearing as a human being. He's incredibly flawed, and he shares a lot of the same values that people do. Winnie the Pooh, I mean...
He likes his honey.
He likes his honey, and he's a friendly dude. You're like, all right, good for you, man.
But, like, Joel's a way more, like, deep character. I think that I love Walter White more than I love Winnie the Pooh.
Yeah, same.
Like,
Walter White, loved character.
Absolutely.
He was saying something about violence here. This is the thing. He's saying he's not a beloved character because he's violent. That doesn't have it.
We'll have to let him say his thing first, I guess.
Quote, a beloved character. Joel is not a fucking beloved character.
He's saying, I worry, Winnie... just let me see her, please, in that clip.
Yeah, I know. It's...
Okay. Not what I would have chosen to make this point, but okay.
The Pooh is a beloved character. Joel is a violent anti-hero. There are scenes...
Well, what does that have to do with whether he's beloved?
Yeah. Sorry, why is he doing that? Why is he killing this guy?
I guess Deadpool is not a beloved character, then.
Yeah, what the fuck? Nope. We can name... This is so.
Punisher.
What?
Man.
This is all contextual as well. This is a world where people have to be violent in order to to stay alive. This isn't a place where Winnie the Pooh would thrive.
What about Rorschach? People fucking adore Rorschach.
Like, Joel is not virtuous, but that doesn't have anything to do with him being.
People
what about Batwoman?
The Joker. Like, the Joker is a psychopathic, chaos-ridden fucking monster. He's beloved. This is not how emotions work.
And this clip of him fucking this guy up, and like, why is he doing that?
Han Solo is an anti-hero.
There's so many characters.
I think he thinks to be beloved is to be appreciated for your altruism or something, like pure altruism, like there's nothing negative about you. Because Winnie the Pooh, has Winnie the Pooh ever sinned in any way, shape, or form?
Winnie the Pooh is like
Winnie the Pooh is without sin. He is the perfect being.
Well, let's look at this then. Like, if you're going to take it on like having a flawless personality and being altruistic, like, is Rey a beloved character? Not really. But she exemplifies all the virtues that cosmonauts apparently looking for.
Luke got really mad when he was fighting Vader. I guess he's no longer beloved. He failed once, so you know he's not good anymore.
Not every beloved character is Captain America. Like you can be flawed and still be a beloved character. It's just a matter of like if people relate.
Another one, Iron Man. You know,
Winnie the Glutton. Oh God,
Winnie the Don.
Winnie suffered gluttonous tendencies that he had to overcome.
I mean, we did the EFAP not too long ago about Lord of the Rings and favorite characters. Boromir pops up all the time.
Incredibly super flawed.
Beloved. Yeah.
This is what I mean. Like, this is such a weird focus of this video. Like, what is all this in aid of? Stop being so sad that he's dead. Like, what?
What is somebody meant to do about that? I don't know. Like.
In the first game where he murders people just because he wants to.
No! 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 This scene right here is not the scene that you use to say that he just kills people because he wants to. Yeah. He is trying to save Ellie's life, you fucking prick!
Stop yelling, it's weird.
Oh my god!
Like, just to kill somebody. When does he kill someone just for the sake of killing someone in the first Last of Us? I don't think he does that once.
Listen,
there's a reason for the evil aspect
of his character that we're told about is the fact that he would attack and steal from, you know, innocent people. That's not even a want to kill. So well, even like whole, at the worst aspect we know of his character, to want, like, what do you mean wants to kill?
No, Joel is just sadistic. He just has this bloodlust. He just kills people because he wants to. He's the serial killer. He doesn't kill for self-defense. He doesn't kill to survive. He just has this urge, this primal urge to just kill. He has to kill.
Like the clip that supports it, though, like this clip where he's interrogating this guy so that he can save Ellie. Yeah, he kills because he likes it.
Terrible example.
He is told that Ellie is being prepped for surgery. There is a ticking clock. Time is of the essence. He literally says, "I have no time for this," and then shoots the dude in the groin. Like, fuck.
Yeah.
Like he had a reason for that as well. You'll just come after her. So he always kills some. He always kills with
it's
a reason.
Very pragmatic. He's very pragmatic. Like, yeah.
Scenes in the first game where he murders people just because he wants to. I think a lot of people wrongfully believe that this is a story about how you have to protect your loved ones, no matter the cost.
I'm curious what you think the story is about.
Yeah.
He has taken some strange things from this game.
Yeah.
Hopefully he'll tell me what he thinks the first game was about.
I'm really interested in seeing his interpretation. It's going to be like one that doesn't line up with mine at all, but I am curious to see what he has to say about it.
Joel saves Ellie because he desperately does not want to lose another daughter. There is no point.
He doesn't want to lose the first daughter either, and both of those are classed as loved ones. So what goes against that doesn't counter what he just said.
He wants to protect his loved ones.
He doesn't want Tess to die either. Like, what are you?
Yeah, why? How is that like selfish?
I don't understand.
Like, you're protecting people that you love. Like, surely that's.
He says it like it's a flaw that he doesn't want his surrogate daughter to die. You're like, okay. I think a lot of people wouldn't want that, but alright.
Point where he grapples with the morality of his choice. He wants to save Ellie, he does not care about curing humanity. This is a sad ending, and not because humanity is doomed, but.
That's a lot to infer. But that's a lot to infer as well, like, to say that he doesn't care.
It's
like,
not
you don't know that. He might be deeply like conflicted about this, but he does the thing that's most important.
Yeah, the game doesn't like have him announce it. Like, as he runs through the hallway shooting all of the fireflies, he doesn't say, "I'm doing this because I don't care about the cure." Rah. More so, it's clear that he values Ellie's life over the potential of a cure. But that was the beauty about the first game. It was all very interpretable. Not anymore.
But because we spend the whole game watching these two learn to care for each other, and bantering and joking and sharing personal heartwarming experiences with each other, And now that's ruined forever.
Ellie by The Last knows... of Us 2.
Well, I'm assuming that's not ruined. He's presenting that as a poor argument, I think, because I don't think he agrees with that.
In her heart that Joel is not telling the whole truth, and that he lied to her face even though she told him not to.
Okay, I guess,
yeah. The lie is, if anything, the lie is maybe even the worst thing he does, which is nothing comparatively.
Yeah.
But I don't like this framing that she's like fucking pissed at him for lying when this whole scene runs so clearly to me that she knows that he's doing this for a reason and that she's agreeing to it almost. She's like, very yep. well.
100%.
It would take a cosmic retard to wake up in the back of his car in a fucking hospital gown and be like, everything went fine? He's like, yep, everything went fine. Yep.
Yep, moon's haunted.
Like, seems a bit weird. Seems like you're not telling me the whole truth. Nope, I am 100% telling you all of the truth you would ever need. Trust me. You're like, all right.
I trust you, Joel, because of the adventures we've gone on and how much I know you care for me.
Nah, she's just dumb, guys.
This is the thing. They're very specific about this, because she doesn't go, okay, and then walks off. She goes, okay. Like, yeah. I get it. You're lying. But it's probably for a good reason. This is why people like this ending so much, just FYI. It's a very specific delivery of the word okay. Look at that face. She knows what's up.
And because of that, she can never really forgive him again. Bullshit. There's virtually nothing heroic in this story at all.
You fuck gotta be kidding
off.
Me.
Actually go and fuck off. This is insane. If all of you aspiring film critics and game reviewers out there, if you don't think that you have enough talent to make it big, I promise you fucking do.
Yes.
Anybody can become a big YouTuber. Like
you can get this big while being wrong all the time. It's pretty impressive.
It's shocking. It's just like anybody can, for better or worse, anybody can become famous.
And yet people still see Joel as a hero. If Ellie had it her way, she would have died, because at this point she is not a selfish person.
It's insane. She's making an extremely ill-informed decision also, based on conjecture of anything.
You can't use the Last of Us 2 canon to explain that's how Last of Us 1 canon is actually 100%. We don't know what would have happened if we'd talked to her. We never find out. We've got information to believe she might have been willing to sacrifice herself. She also wouldn't be ready to commit to something like that. We don't know for sure. And I don't think she would had you explained all of the variables to her. I don't think anyone would. It's essentially asking you to fucking kill yourself. You'd be like, why? It's like, not really any reason. There's a very low percent chance that anything good will even happen.
The gall of this person to make arguments this retarded and then to title his video, "You guys are just dumb."
Certainly showed us.
Crazy. From her perspective, Joel took the choice away from her. And now this
story...
She
didn't have
a choice.
There was no choice to take away.
They took the choice from her.
Yep.
She had absolutely no choice. So the choice is either to have her die without her consent or save her life without her consent. And to fight in the preservation of life is always going to be the more moral decision in that case, the information that he has.
He's such a shitty YouTuber that he can look at the stuff Joel does next to what the Fireflies have done and like, yeah, Joel's the bad guy. Like, that's how detached from reality this person is.
It's probably why people like Joel even more is the fact that this just, everybody's throwing piles of shit on him and he's like, all right, if that's, you know, I got what I wanted, which was saving Ellie. I guess I'll take the slings and arrows at this point. Like, man, you're a legend.
Just gotta ignore all the, you know, the context, all the information and visual cues that were given to, you know, imply that maybe the Fireflies are actually the villains here.
It fucking blows my mind that he's considered the one who took the choice away. That's so bullshit.
It's nuts.
Ellie
like,
takes
what do you mean you
Joel.
Stopped us from operating on this girl without her consent that would kill her? Can't believe Joel took her choice away that she didn't have.
I don't think that any doctor worth their salt would be willing to operate on a senior citizen, like a 100-year-old person, without their consent to find a definite sure shot cure for COVID-19.
So does it make sense that they're like trying to gun him down while he's running with her at the end of The Last of Us? Isn't that pretty stupid of them?
Yeah.
Pretty dangerous, yeah.
If they truly believe she is the cure to humanity, you'd think... See, this is what I mean. And well, it's funny because you either...
I guess as long as they don't hit her in the head.
Oh, sure. I mean, I was just going to say, like, you can interpret that as, like, plot holy, or you can go the direction of Firefly's probably hoping to make it a power play, and they don't actually, like, have any intention of fucking curing the world. We don't know. They have the audio logs that are like, oh, this will be so great for you, man. It's like, how, though? Like, how are you... There's so many unanswered questions about that.
Joel's traits. The game opens with her learning how to play guitar like he does. And then we also see her become more comfortable with killing like he was.
She was always comfortable with killing.
Did you play the first game?
Yeah.
What the fuck?
Like, there is a gameplay clip that I saw on Reddit where she is chasing after a dude. Like, yeah. He is running away, basically shitting his pants. And she just sprints after him. He disappears around a corner. She disappears right behind him. And then you just hear the guy going, ah, and dying because she's like stabbing him to death. Like, I know that's a gameplay bit that's probably subjective and doesn't happen in most playthroughs, but I don't know, man. She seems comfortable.
If she's programmed to do that, that's still her in the world.
Absolutely,
operating.
Yeah.
The only exception you get to this is that scene where she returns from having tortured one
Which
of
makes
Abby's
sense,
friends.
By the way. She like,
yeah, considering everything else she's done up until that point, the fact that she had to torture one person leaves her traumatized is just a weird choice.
That said, yeah, the bitch got what he deserved. Like, okay, yeah, I'm not gonna feel, dude. Like when I was playing, I was like, "All right, your life doesn't matter," and I just like chased after her with like, "All right, come here, Nora," and then I got to her, and I relished in each time I tapped square in the scene. Ah,
I mean, I'm just of the perspective that this is nonsense to me. Like, it's like the first game just doesn't fucking exist. And some people are referencing the David kills being proof that like she has trouble with murder or whatever. But it's like,
but
it's
what
clearly
about all
not
the people up until that point in that sequence.
It's clearly not the violence of David's kill. It's the how close she came to possibly being raped, how she was trapped and set to be eaten by the rest of them at some point, and the fact that she's alone and fighting for herself for so long. I see that scene. You're chopping him up into pieces of meat as like, oh my fucking god, like this is stressful. This
also,
whole situation, yeah, is
it's
very stressful.
Pointing out that for a lot of players, that was one of the most terrifying scenes in the game. So the terror that the player is feeling, Ellie would probably be feeling that a thousandfold.
Yep.
But to say she kills like 15 people in the mall and left
exactly.
behind.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
She didn't have any problem with that. And it's because they were trying to kill Joel. Like that's why she killed them, and she didn't have any problem with that. So yeah.
We see her exacting her revenge in the same way as him, except it takes a toll on her. I personally.
Oh, and sorry, I forgot. Mahler, during your playthrough of the first game, she is carrying on a casual conversation with you. And then she just kills two guys while in the middle of that.
Also, killing for revenge, like Joel. Did Joel ever kill people for revenge in Last of Us?
Not well. Yeah. Okay, so he like breaks Robert's arm for revenge.
Okay.
Remember the beginning?
There's where he's that. Interrogating the two guys to find out where Ellie is, and he just kills the second dude. You know, just like. Yeah, it's okay. I believe him, but that's not really revenge.
That's not a necessity, I think.
They were.
Yeah, I'd say it's a necessity. Yeah.
They were complicit in Ellie's kidnapping. They were going to kill him. It's like, yeah, it's. I'm fine with him doing that.